This is the title. Bamboo. Be careful. Why do you have two hands on the table? Okay. Come on.
Bring this time.
Okay, don't sleep. Okay, come on. This is the title. So the theme is about much of the things that I would say with rock fragments. As I know, is that right? Okay. As I know, the rock fragment skeleton or soil skeleton is a sort of argument quite neglected. I will present some basic knowledge about rock fragments. Maybe you know, but don't sleep, please, during this sort of basic knowledge I will give you now. So rock fragments or skeleton clasts, it has so many names, are all the particles with diameter larger than 2 millimeters. These are the stones. There are so many names. The finer, what we usually define as earth finds, is all the fraction made, working on the diffraction. I would like the bamboo too.
The bamboo is better.
Bamboo is good. It's diffraction made of particles less than 2 millimeters. You know, as Earth is subdivided in sand, silt, and clay, and many subdivisions of these sizes, we have also many different names for rock fragments. So, depending on the size, we call the rock fragments as pebbles, calcules, boulders, more or less the same for the FAO, gravel, stone, boulder, lud boulders. Then we have a special name for this sort of stones that are elongated, so where one dimension is larger than the other dimensions. So for these elongated stones, we use the name of channels. So because of this, we may define soils as stony or skeletal soils when they have 40 or 35, depending on the agencies. Even though this is on mass and this is on volume basis, but more or less, let's say it's quite similar, we may define skeletal soil as those soil having more than 35-40% of rock fragments or skeleton or whatever. We call channel soils the soil that had more than 15% channels. On the basis of this definition, the 30% of the Western Europe is made of stony soils. And here, Mediterranean, the soil falling in the Mediterranean basin are 60% stony soils. Huge, huge surface. We may consider these data as really bad data, bad circumstances, bad soils. You know, farmers and many other technicians consider stones, rock fragments, a big problem. They are big, maybe they are big stones, but is it really a big problem to have stones into the soil? I would like to change your mind about this, let's say, thing. I don't know this thing, but is a sort of idea that raised in our mind when we are baby. You know, stones, the farmers, daddy say, oh boy, all these stones, oh boy, all these stones, come on. Not really, stones are so bad, or maybe we have to manage all these stones to improve quality of the soil. Until 15 years ago, the idea was also in the scientific academia. The idea about the stones was really the stones are devil. Stones in the soil are really the devil. There are also some religions that consider stones derived from devil. Really, in India, if you go, they find the earth is considered the fruit of the godliness, but the stones is the fruit of the devil. Incredible. So this is really a problem for humankind. To have stones is considered to be a big problem, to have stones into the soil. Nonetheless, from the physical point of view, stones, rock fragments, play a positive role. This is all the positive role that stones may have into the soil. So increased hydraulic conductivity, increased water holding capacity, quite strange, eh? Increase water holding capacity. This means the stones are porous. Those that are porous. Then there are stones, let's say, not porous or not really porous, but they may increase water holding capacity, increase field trafficability. So you may go in the field with tractors whenever you want. Then reduction of evapotranspiration when you have stones at the surface. Obviously. This is so easy to erode a particle of 10 or 100 micrometers. If you have a stone like this, this is quite difficult to move it. Then reduce soil compaction, control weeds. If you seed barley or wheat, this is a problem, obvious. Weeds. Herbaceous species, also wheat and barley are herbaceous species, so it's a problem. But they also affect soil temperature and influence albedo. So they are all positive role, but physical properties. Obviously, the rock fragments may play also negative roles, and here are listed some of those. Obstacle and adequate seedbed preparation, especially for grass, so wheat, barley, and so on. Mm-hmm. Obstacle and precise sowing. You know, now we are going to precise agriculture, so really straight lines where to put seeds if you have big stones is the problem. So, obstacle the harvesting, obstacle plantation of young trees, and also, in case of vineyards, for example, obstacle stick plantation, if you have to stick, if you have big boulders, that could be a problem. Also, they also obstacle mechanical works, obviously, and this is a problem of mining, especially, they also increase deterioration of mechanical devices like teeth or disc and so on. However, for cultivation like let's say trees or vineyards, olive oil or in trees and so on, many of these obstacles are not really an obstacle. Stones like of 10-15 centimeters, maybe they are a problem for grass cultivation, but not really for trees cultivation. So I have presented you positive and negative well-known aspects of the rock fragments. In the last 15 years, we have demonstrated that rock fragments are also chemically, biological, and mineralogically active. And here are listed all the properties that, depending on lithology, rock fragments may have. So here we have in many rock fragments, we may have carbon and nitrogen, organic matter, and other substances too, available phosphorus, nutritive cations, cation exchange capacity, you know, we consider the elements they are part of cation exchange capacity as available nutrients. Contain nucleic acids, DNA, RNA, active minerals, and host and microbial biomass. After a short discussion with Claudio, yesterday evening, I decided to put this picture on it. There's a picture of stones, in particular, these three pictures are of a trachyte, volcanic rock, trachyte, and the stone was around 15 centimeters of diameter. So it really big class. Huh? But after crushing the clast, the new surface, the broken surface, show this aspect here, pores full of hyphae. Those are hyphae. This is a sandstone, another mythology, and those are bacteria into 5 centimeters into from the surface into the stone. So they are really, even from the microbiological point of view, they are active. If you have biomass, microbial biomass, you are also a sort of background to become other stuff. In fact, one of the end of the rock fragments is to become fine earth. So, because of the alteration of the rock fragments, once rock fragments will become rock fragments. And during this process of becoming fine earth, the rock fragments release cations, not always nutritive cations, but also nutritive cations, and many other stuff, including affecting the role of organic matter, the quantity of organic matter, affecting the quality of the microbial biomass that will be part of the entire soil. So rock fragments are really an active part of the soil, depending on lithology, obviously. On their specific surface. It is obvious that if we assume a rock fragment as a bowl without porosity, the specific surface of a bowl of 10 centimeter diameter is really none. So having this small specific surface, also chemical reaction are so few. And because of this, if we compare the specific surface of a bowl of 10 centimeters with the fine earth that is made of particles with less than 2 millimeters of diameter, the specific surface of a bowl is quite or completely negligible. So because of this, when we have rock fragments with very large size, they have also a very small specific surface, and because of this, their contribution to the release of nutrients and all the other reactions is really negligible. But if we have rock fragments with many pores inside, you know, for the dimension of an atom, of a cation, can you imagine the dimension of a cation? A cation? We measure the cations in angstrom, 1/10 of a nanometer, the angstrom. Porosity, we measure the porosity in micrometer. So for a cation, 1 micrometer is a sort of person into a cathedral. So there is no problem of space if we have porous into a rock fragments. Porous into rock fragments is the same to have porous into fine earth. It's quite the same, it's really the same. What is different is water flow from inside to outside of rock fragments. As the water has to penetrate and come into those convoluted porosity, and so from outside to really reach the internal of the rock fragments, this requires time. So because of this, even though reactions doesn't change from inside and outside the rock fragments, the rates, the velocity, is quite reduced for rock fragments. as obvious, all this argument having three more many soil scientists in the last decades, and have also changed minds for many persons. So here, as I told you before, I will present some data about unpublished data, so really new. First, you will see the story here. So, about rock fragments and their capability to supply nutrients. Materials, so easy. This is a sandstone, one is sandstone. The sandstone will be called macigno. For Italian guys, this name is quite common. Macigno is a lithology name very used. So this is sandstone. And the other is a marl, calcareous marl. The name is alberese. Big boulders, the material. From these boulders, we had removed the first, the superficial 4-5 centimeters, just to have pure or really fresh rock without any sort of alteration at the surface. Then we had crushed the boulders so clean and made this fraction by sieving. All these fractions, except the first one, were washed over a sieve, so no powder. These rock fragments here, they are not affected by the presence of small amount of powders, fine powders that can be improved reactions, right? And then we have analyzed then at time zero, meaning when we start, and then after these stones have been buried for 6 and 12 months. So we put the stones into bags like this. These bags have a size, a mesh, that doesn't prevent the entry of the roots, so the roots can enter into the bags. As you know, we may use also bags that prevent the enter of roots, but in this case, no. We wanted the roots to enter into the bags. And then we bury it, like here, these bags in a vineyard, implanted on the soil, on the same lithology. So, the bags containing macigno, the sandstones, were planted into a vineyard whose soil derived from sandstone. And the same for the marl, for the alberese.
At what depth?
15 centimeters. Yeah, 15, 20. From 15 to 20 centimeters. Methods, we measure bulk density, porosity, pH, and so many other things. As I would like to remark this one here. We measure, we call this soluble plus exchangeable. You know that when we measure cation exchange capacity, we call this measure cation exchange capacity. We consider the cations as exchangeable. But it is obvious that together with exchanged cations, there are also solubilized cations. When we work with fine earth, the soluble cations are so few that we are considered they are not considered, they are negligent. So, neglected. So, we say usually exchangeable cations. But if we work with rock fragments, especially with new surface, the surface produced by crushing the rock fragments, the soluble part of both the release cations is quite high. As you have fresh surface, and so you have hydrolyzation, and so release of soluble cations together, obviously with the changeable cations, but the soluble is a good part. So, soluble plus the changeable calcium, potassium, and magnesium in barium chloride, and the solution with cations was extracted, and one season. After 150 days, 5 months. The first one, the sensor, machine. Specific density is by usual 2.6, something like that. Bulk density close to. Porosity is more. With respect to fine earth, this is a very, very, very small porosity, 4%. Now, almost balls, brilliant balls. This is the pH of the different classes that we obtain by crushing. Usual. Sandstone always contains a little bit calcium carbonate, so the pH is around 8.3456, it depends on. In the less than 2 millimeter fraction, pH is 8.3, but there are also some 8.9, that depends on the possibility to have also a little bit sodium carbonate, so the pH may raise. But this is not really exciting data, there are some normal. Come on, available phosphorus, available, not total. Doesn't matter total, but total is available phosphorus. Available phosphorus obviously is shown only in the less than 2 millimeter fraction. We would remember you that all this fraction come from the same boulders, right? The same boulders. Crash, tilt to head this fraction. But this is evidently the effect of the size. Smaller the size, higher the possibility to release something. In this case, available phosphorus. Here we have the available phosphorus at time zero, after 6 months and after 12 months of burying. I will explain you now, then we will have the same situation shown here. This measure has been done after the clasp had been buried and allowed to stay there to rest for 6 months. Then I unburied the clasp, washed it a bit, and then submitted to the cation and change capacity measurements. Right? So this, what happened here, is evidently the fruit of the, let's say, treatment the clasp had during the burying for 6 months or 1 year. Is it clear? Come on. And I know this is a tremendous part. Come on.
How can you tell for sure that what is the sink and what is the source? I mean.
Right. As after washing. We
wash. Not only washing, even before washing. How do you know that the phosphorus didn't come from the environment to the rock? So you claim that the phosphorus is there and just moving from the inner side to the.
Yeah, this is a good question. For phosphorus, this could happen. In the case of phosphorus, do you understand the question? The phosphorus could also come from outside, as the phosphorus could also have been linked, trapped from the surface of the stones, in this case. But for the other data, I will show you, this is not possible. They are impossible that the calcium, magnesium, and potassium come from outside. This is the 2 to 10, 10 to 25, 25 to 50 millimeters, and this is only the three fraction presented on this one here. So what happened is that from time zero to 6 and then to 12, even though fractions are quite diverse here, the availability of phosphorus increased. To me, it doesn't matter if this phosphorus is coming from inside of the stones or if the stones had trapped the phosphorus that was mobilized from the fine earth. What is important is that the stones are active. They had reacted with the soil in the time. In both cases, releasing or trapping during the 6 months under the soil, and then releasing during the experiments of available phosphorus measurement. In this case, for example, exchangeable ammonium, in this case too, the question could be applied. But this is no, this was followed by mineralogical analysis. You know, here this is the changeable ammonium at time zero all diffraction. This ammonium is coming from the micas. You know, sandstone, micas is a family of minerals, muscovite biotite, and the interlayer of these minerals is made of potassium. But in some extent, potassium is replaced by ammonium. So during alteration, this ammonium and potassium are released from the interlayer of these minerals. So this ammonium is coming from the alteration, in this case, a time zero, from the hydrolyzation, fresh time zero, hydrolyzation of the micas. In this case here, this is the same hydrolyzation, but here ammonium is coming also from the alteration of the micas, not only hydro, but also really it changed ammonium. So this ammonium is released from the stones, and we have followed this release by the measurement of the alteration of the micas that were contained at the surface of the stones. So, sort of increase, even though at time 6, quite similar to time 0. Organic carbon, this is the time 0 fraction situation. Obviously, is organic carbon is higher in the defined fraction, even though this is carbon, geological carbon, so this is an internal carbon. Sandstone is a sedimentary rock, so it also contains organic matter, geological, sedimented into the sea. Is it right? Sedimentary stone, sedimentary rock, a sedimented material into the sea together with organic matter, so this is an organic carbon of geological origin. It's high in the fine fraction because the specific surface is high. So, in this case, after 6 and 12 months, for each fraction, we may observe a decrease. This story was observed in many other work, really pathological work, looking at the first phases of soil formation. If you start from a sedimentary rock, meaning containing organic carbon, the first phases of soil formation induce organic carbon decreasing. Then, when the soil will be more developed, the organic carbon will increase again. But the first phase of soil formation on sedimentary rocks means decreasing of organic carbon, organic matter. The organic carbon that was already present at the beginning, so at the first phase of soil formation. And this is done by the activation of microflora that, without any pathogenic organic matter, uses the organic matter already present in the rock. You see? So, here, during the first phases of alteration of the rock, we have decreasing of organic matter. And this is the why we had less at 6 and even less at 12. So, these rock fragments have released organic matter, they're not really released. They have furnished organic matter to the microbes that have respired these organic matter during 6 and 12 months. The way of organic matter, as in this case we total nitrogen, this is not ammonium, this is, the ammonium is comprised in, but the total nitrogen is obviously mostly organic, and so follows the trend of organic matter. The other rock, albinism, the marl, porosity, poser, one poser, or one third of the other rock. Here pH is quite high, marl. Much of this is calcium carbonate with a little bit sodium carbonate, so pH is usually higher than in sandstone. It's not exciting. Is the presence of calcium carbonate, as phosphorus is black, fixed by the calcium contained as calcium carbonate. This happens even during sedimentation of these rocks, when these, the particles that will become rock are sedimented into the sea, all the forms of phosphorus that arrive in the sedimentation area are trapped by all this calcium carbonate that is sedimenting at the same time. So if you produce this sort of fraction by crushing, a little part, look the unit of measure, milligram per cubic decimeter. This is 1, 2, 3. It's few, huh? But a small part of this phosphorus that was blocked by the calcium carbonate during sedimentation of the particles, that after 6-10 millions of years will become a rock, part of this phosphorus is blocked and now is released. Did you get it? More or less? Did you get it? Too many concepts? Tell me. Is it following this or is come on. Clear. I dislike if you didn't get some part of this, otherwise it's difficult to reach the end. Is it clear? More or less. Maybe 50% is understandable. Come on, it's sufficient.
If this is the explanation, so you should have more phosphorus in the smaller particles, no?
Yeah, that's because of the specific surface. It's not because here there is more available phosphorus than here or here. In the smaller the fraction, higher the specific surface, so the solubilization of the release reactions are facilitated. Then I know you say, oh, but here this is higher, so the specific surface should be there. We should accept, when we are working with rock fragments, we should accept that variability is tremendous. You know why? We try to work, you know, usually we work with beakers or small containers into the lab. When you work with stones, we should use bucket. So we prepare for these experiments a sort of 1 cubic meter of barium chloride. No 1 liter. 1 liter is 1 liter. It stays into a beaker like this, 1 liter. We prepare 1 cubic meter. 1,000 liters of barium chloride. Is it huge? So, when you work with buckets instead of beakers, you know, variability is tremendous. And even working with buckets, you know, we are not so able to control variability among the stones. Stones are stones. When you use stones like this, or 5 kilos, this means that to respect 1 to 10 solid liquid ratio, with a stone of 5 kilos, we had to put 50 liters of barium chloride, you know, and we had used one stone. Come on. So if you put 3 stones, you had to use 150 liters of barium chloride, come on. And you had used 3 particles, you know, this is a problem. So variability is really tremendous when we work with rock fragments. So, thank you for the question, as this has allowed me to explain better this fact. So, working with stones, and when I say this is higher, in fact, if you have noted, I rarely used during my presentation now, it increases and it decreases. I prefer to avoid increases and decreases, as I know that variability is high. What I would give you is the meaning, the idea, to demonstrate that rock fragments are active. Maybe here the trend is decreasing. For another, if I had used other fragments, maybe the trend was exactly the different, but doesn't matter. What is important here is that this rock fragment coming from the crush of fresh rocks release phosphorus. For the different fraction that you say, yeah, as you see here, the availability is reduced. Maybe in this case, these rocks have released available phosphorus. The same with exchangeable ammonium here, it still comes from the alteration of hydrolyzation and alteration of the micas. Still contained in this rock. Organic carbon is the same, it's a sedimentary rock. So organic carbon is present also at the beginning. Here there is a counter tendency from time 0 to time 6, but then it appears to be a decrease during the first phase of alteration. Total nitrogen is expected. So calcium, magnesium and potassium. The same story for time 6 and time 12. Buried, then extracted, retrieved from the soil, washed, and then submitted to cation exchange capacity experiments. So this is within time 5 months. Should I repeat? 6 or 12 months buried, retrieved, washed, and then put into a bucket for 5 months. To see after alteration received into the soil what happened during 5 months. And I would say also that here time 0 is higher, that doesn't matter. What the general view here is that during 5 months there is a continuous release here, a continual release of calcium, magnesium, and potassium. Sandstone. Still sandstone. That before was solid, 2 to 10 fraction. This is 20, the biggest one, 25 to 50. Same story. Increase. Obviously. Yeah. General trend, eh? Take please the general trend. Don't mean, about here after 4 months, and what is it? Okay, come on, I know. This is the total calcium, potassium, and magnesium released from these fractions after 5 months of submersion into barium chloride. This is the amount of, in terms of gram per cubic decimeter, of calcium chloride release. Not negligible, I would say. Not negligible. this is the most interest
datum
I will show you. That's, yeah, come on. One plus, but after 5 months, come on, the number are not so quite interesting. And this is for Machinio, and the same, I didn't show you all the curves for Alberese, and this is the same for Alberese. Not nearly, obviously in Alberese calcium is really higher than in sandstone. This is a marked calcium carbonate. Obviously the release of calcium is higher. But also in terms of magnesium and potassium, I say very few, but not nearly. Time lasted is I will be ready for the second part, but if you agree, just to rearrange all the idea, I would suggest to have 5-10 minutes.
Sure,
or
sure.
If you,
we can break for 10 minutes.
Oh, okay, this is the second part that is expected to be the one of the possible application, application of all these, the final application, I don't know how to say it, but the final application of all these results. First of all, what raised from all these data, that the presence of rock fragments is not really a dilution of the final properties. You know, there are a sort of schizophrenic behavior in the soil scientists. One part of this schizophrenic behavior is, come on, soil is 70% rock fragments, so the fine is 30%, I analyze the fine, and the soil is the fine. Let me be more clear. Inductively, I suppose that the soil is made only by fine. Can you hear? Can you understand this? So the fine is 30-40%. I analyze what? Define, and in my mind there is that the soil is defined. Doesn't matter about the presence of 50, 60, 70% of the skeleton. The soil is defined. That's all.
Yeah. That's what we use when we calculate carbon stocks.
Exactly.
Only the fine.
Exactly. The other part of the schizophrenic behavior is, okay, come on. The fine earth is 30%. 70% is the skeleton. This is a more ahead behavior, right? More scientific behavior. I calculate the dilution made by the 70% skeleton over the properties of the 30% fine. So, in one case, we are over, the first case, we are over evaluating the soil properties when I consider in the tipping that the soil is defined. In the second case, I under-evaluate the soil as I dilute the fine property by the presence of a certain percentage of rock fragments. The reality is in the middle. So rock fragments is not really a dilution of the fine properties. Rock fragments participate to the soil property. So if they contain a own amount of organic carbon, nitrogen, ammonium, humic substances, whatever, the exact content of the soil is fine properties times the amount of the fines plus rock fragments properties times percent of rock fragments. The sum of these is the soil properties. So it is in the middle. So what derived from these observations is that it is obvious that the soil, the skeletal soil, the stony soils are poorer than the soil that doesn't contain rock fragments. But they are not so poor as we are inductively induced to consider. What is obvious is that the stony soils are not only poorer, but they are submitted to a slow release of nutrients. So is this really a bad circumstance? Maybe in some case, but in other case, no. We know that many plants, many cultivations require slow release of nutrients. Because of this, we invented a slow release fertilizer, right? Otherwise, we didn't need it. Slow releasing fertilizer. So if we have soils that slowly release nutrients, even though in small amounts, we are close to the requirements of many plants. Examples of these plants, of these trees, are vines and olive trees. It is not a case that the best vines come from regions, area with skeletal soils. As you know, maybe you are not so familiar with vines, maybe with drinking wine, but not for producing wine, but the best wines comes from grapes, transformation, that come from vineyards planted in skeletal soil. Or, let's say, poor soil, not so poor, but almost poor soil. As the vine, to produce good grape, from which we can obtain excellent wines, the vines have to be submitted to what we call mild stress. Not really big stress, but a mild stress in terms even for water, than for nutrients. So these soils, skeletal soil, appears like good soils for these trees. For this study, we restricted the research to two provinces in Tuscany. You know, I'm in Ancona, it's in the Marche, but I'm like electron, I vibrate from Marche to Tuscany like this. So, depends on the money. If there are money in Tuscany, if there's Tuscany, there are money there. If you have money here, you come here. So, and if you have money there, come on. So in Tuscany, two provinces, this is Florence and Siena, except some municipalities there was a problem. So we restricted the research on these two provinces. Let me say that the total surface of the vineyard in Tuscany is 60,000 hectares. Materials and methods, but just to say that in these two provinces, the vineyards, only vineyards, are planted on soils that derived, soils, derived, lithology, differentiation, the soils derived from 46 in Florence province and 40 in Siena province lithologies. So, big variety of lithologies. We grouped all these lithologies. You know, geologists, they are sort of crazy. No? You know that rocks can be called sandstone if they have a little bit more calmness, the name changing. We grouped these lithologies. Pedologists are worse than geologists, let's say. But we grouped all these lithologies into 18 families, depending on the type of soil they are able to do, they are able to give. So instead to have 46 or 40 lithology, we have now 18, and each one of this group is able to give a type. of soil. This is it understandable?
Yeah, quite small.
This is the amount of hectares of vineyards for each lithology in Florence and Siena. Bold, in bold, here, the soil, the skeletal soil. So the lithology that is able to, that gives skeletal soils. And so this is the amount of vineyards on that group of lithology. So from here to here, the amount of hectares on skeletal soils. Just in bracket, let me show you here. You know someone is here is a geologist, right? He's a geologist, yeah. Ophiolite. Do you know ophiolite? No? Green rocks, serpentinite, gabbro, diabase. This is a family of these rocks. You know, they are a sort of naturally polluted soil, those derived from ophiolites. They are rich in cadmium, vanadium, chromium, zinc, copper.
Overall heavy metal. It's nature.
Full of, yeah. But the number is 1,000 milligram per kilogram of rock. Because of this, many soils derived from ophiolites are pretty desert, really naked. Naked, barren. Okay, they had the courage to implant vineyards also on this soil. Can you understand the why? The why is the vineyard a cultivation that requires poor soil? Come on. Which is the poorest soil than a barren soil? A barren soil, there should be really poor, otherwise it would be better. So, but the problem here is that it is barren because of the pollution. Is it not pollution, anthropic, but it's natural pollution. So what happened here is that the risk is to have a vine that is drinkable only by the producer. As if you try to sell this wine because of the content of zinc, cadmium, vanadium, right? The risk is to be considered guilty for the public health of the humankind. So this is really a stupid, let's say, equal, all the discussion to say these guys here are stupid. As barren soil doesn't mean poor soil per se, or soil able to give good production or something. Depends on the why a soil is barren. If it is barren, as this is very poor in terms of water and nutrients, this is a condition. But it is, if it is, sorry, poor because of pollution, this is another condition. And it should be avoided with any sort of cultivation. But this is the stupidity of humankind. So this is the situation.
Maybe nobody told them that these are not good for wine.
You know, to plant a vineyard, you must have a professionist, agronomist,
to give advice.
Then we need to get permission from the authorities to plant. Come on, this is too long discussion to read now. Okay, from this data, it appears that about 17% of the total vineyard of the two of these two provinces are derived from sandstone, the Macigno, and the Mar Albarese. Florence and Siena, the 17% of the total vineyard surface is made of soils derived from these two lithologies. If I restrict the number to the total amount of skeletal soils, These two lithologies give 55% of the soil occupied by vineyards. Not bad. It's a big surface. What happened when we are preparing a soil to be implanted with vineyards? Which is the problem? The problem is the presence of this sort of rocks. Till now, what happened, till now meaning till 10 years ago, 7, 8, depending on the region. As you know, for many items in Italy, regions, different regions, Apulia, Tuscany, Umbria, and so on, may legiferate by itself. So in Italy, you may find different laws depending on the region where you are. Sorry. So for Tuscany, the Tuscan law, after 8-10 years ago, I don't remember exactly now, doesn't require so particular activity to discharge all this amount of stones they raised during preparation of the soil. And this is the operation that are usually done to prepare the soil, the use of rippers and then of excavators to remove stones and stack everywhere. This is, you know, this machine here, rippers, single tooth, three teeth ripper, and those are excavators here. Excavator with different bucket. This is a, let's say, common bucket. This is a rake bucket. And what happened during this preparation, especially after till 8-10 years ago, with the huge amount of stones derived from the preparation of the soil, they tried to do something, as obvious. So they used especially the smaller stones into a trench to have a sort of drainage. Even though, you know, let me if this is a pore and this is a pore, you know the water movement, which is the water movement from the water moves from large pore to small pores, but from small pores to large pores there is no movement. So when you put large blocks into a trench and it is expected that the water goes from here to here, you have to expect so much as you should expect that from small pores the water goes to large pores, that this is not really possible. Okay. So, even though this is a practice, let's say, it's not really drainage. This was a way to discharge stones. Not really the big stones, the medium-sized stones, disturbable stones. So it was a way to discharge stones, not really to make a drainage. Another use of this amount of stone is that one, the production of dry walls. Is a good, in this case, is a good use. But you know the amount of stone that can be and buried from the preparation of the vineyard soil. Till the depth of 80 centimeters, no more. You know, when we were crazy in Italy, we dig the soil till 1.5 meters. 1.5 meters for vineyards. Crazy. Till 80 centimeters, we may embury even 3,000 cubic meter of stones, gigantic amounts. So you may do what you want, trenches, stone, that the results is always the same. And it is that you have stones in advance. So the end of the stones is down here. It was this one here. Till 10 years ago, the stones were really discharged at the border of the field, occupying surface in some cases, all surrounding the borders, larger than the field itself. Unbelievable. And more than unbelievable, it cannot be tolerated, as it is a problem for the hydrology of the surrounding places, biodiversity, landscape. You know why I say, this is my opinion, why Tuscany produce good wines? To sell them to tourists. If Tuscany should have good wines without tourists, come on, but why produce wine? It's not really economic. But you know why tourists come in Tuscany or go in Tuscany? Just to see the landscape more than all the architectures and arts products that they have. But without landscape, the region is gone. So all this stuff here is really to avoid all this material. Caves. So, you know, dump, rubbish dump, stratify it into rubbish dump. Then they occupy volume for rubbish. So this is a problem that run itself. It is impossible to solve without raise another problem. So because of this, we try to put together the results obtained from the research on release of nutrients and so on with management of the stones into the soil, just to avoid or try to avoid, minimize the problem that can be raised during preparation of the soil. And try to reintroduce the skeleton into the soil, avoiding the problems that the skeleton undoubtedly can give. We may also have the advantage to introduce a sort of slow releasing fertilizer. So, what is my suggestion, or our suggestion? Is mine is like bad, possibly, yeah? Our. Yeah. I was not alone during this work. Maybe I was the one that worked less than the other. So really, I'm not really a thief, but more or less. Suggestion, which is a suggestion. Obviously, the first operation are as usual. Single tooth, three teeth ripper, remove stones and so on. Then we have to use excavator to obviously remove big stones from the soil. We may use in parallel this rake bucket excavator that allow us to sieve coarsely, really in a rough way, sieve all this material just to stack in some places in the field mounds of big stones and leaving the soil small stones. These elements of the rake can be in some case modulated. So I want 15, 10, 20 centimeters, depending on the vineyard, depending on the olive tree. And then what we try to put together, and now is quite in fashion, the use of this machine here, is this. Another sort is Joe Crusher. So we have two big elements that crush fungi. Yeah, like this. You may put in stones of even 140 kilograms, these stones, right? And this machine here that is self-propellant is not good. Huh? It is not good? Is it good? It is self-propellant, can move by itself. This is the meaning. You have not had to put this machine over a tractor or over, and then this is self-propellant machine. And if you put in 1,000 cubic meter of stones, you may have a crusher productivity of 200 tons per hour, meaning that 1,000 cubic meter can be crushed in 12, 13 hours of work of this machine. What is the advantage of this? In 12 hours, 1,000 cubic meter, 12 hours of work of this machine, we may reach this fragmentation here. So the big fraction, the more represented fraction is due of the biggest stones, right? Obviously. Even though, should I say to the machine to obtain smaller fragmentation, I could do it, but obviously the time needed is not 12 hours, but maybe 20, 25. So we found a good compromise. Obviously there is always a big dilemma. Finer but more cost, or bigger reducing costs. Okay, we had to manage this dilemma case by case. We found that the good compromise on these two parts, costs and fragmentation, was to obtain this sort of fragmentation. This is obviously an idea, right? This is a sort of fragmentation here with the biggest fraction as the most represented with respect to the smaller fraction. But I would remark that even the biggest fraction here is 50 millimeter, meaning that the biggest stones is like this. Is not a problem for any sort of tree cultivation. It could be a problem for grass, wheat, barley, but not for any sort of tree. So, with sort of compromise, what we obtain, this is the total introduction of calcium, potassium, and magnesium, total. We should insert into the soil this kilogram per cubic meter of calcium, potassium, and magnesium. But this is not important. What is important is that introducing these fractions into the soil without any time losing to think if this fraction had been buried, leave at the surface. What happened? This sort of fragmentation here doesn't give any problem to cultivation. And with this sort of fragmentation, what we may calculate are the elements introduced, and then after 5 months, that was our experimentation. And then after 5 months, what would be the amount of nutrients released by these crushed 1,000 cubic meter of stones? Is it clear? This amount of calcium, of potassium and magnesium for the sandstone, and this amount here for machine. Consider this amount of nutrients as total release after 5 months, respecting the results that we obtained during the experiments of releasing nutrients after bathing. Do you remember the first hour, right? During the our experiments, this is the amount. So this is for the first 5 months of the presence of plant into a soil. They have received the reintroduction of stone fragmented in this way with 12 hours of work for a machine. You have not really a slow release of nutrients, but only for stones, without considering the finer, a big, huge release of nutrients, only for the stones. What this means? It means that during the first months of plant, of the small plants, they may enjoy, I would say, of a big nutrition state of the soil. So they may grow in a proper way without any sort of pests. As you know, pests diffuse into the plants, especially when we have excess of nitrogen fertilization, as sclerification of the tissues. This is what avoid pest invasion. So, in this way, oh sorry, there was in 5 months, yeah? Okay, sorry. Before, as I said, this is for Massimo and Alberis. No, sorry, this is for Massimo till this the total release, and this is the year the calculated, the expected years of duration of this advantage. Let's say. This comes from calculation, considering the slope of the curve during which this fraction release calcium, potassium, and magnesium. By calculation, we may calculate the years during which this release will be maintained. So, these numbers are the total calcium, potassium, and magnesium released after 5 months. Considering the reduce of this release, we may expect that a good release of nutrients will be maintained last for 2,000 years, depending on the elements. And this is the story for Alberese. The amount of elements released in the mark, obviously calcium is the more release time, and this is the duration, expected duration of this effect for always for 1,000 cubic meter. These data are referred to the number I show you before, 1,000 cubic meter of stones crush in this sort of fermentation. So, conclusions. What can be the, could be the advantages derived from the reintroduction of stones, rock fragments into the soil? The first one that is more interesting from the agronomic point of view is that plants may enjoy of a release of nutrients for years, many years, much more years than the economic life of a vineyard or olive trees plantation. From here, some years, 2,000 years. See? And what is important is that in the first months of plantation, plants may enjoy of a strong supply of cations that are able to decrease the invasion of pests. Okay. In the following years, these fragments will behave like a slow-releasing fertilizer. The other, the reintroduction is favorable from an ecological CO2 release, for example. As I show you the use of this machine, the jaw crusher, this is obviously consumes oil. But consider that to move all these stones to the damp, oil is also consumed with trucks and everything. And then, what is also understandable is that during the release of nutrients, stones will become fine earth. So, this is not a sort of plastic material that are active for dozens of years and then they become spent. They are active for dozens of years or centuries and then they become a more active fraction, which is known as the fungus. So nothing is really lost during these operations, for instance.
Wow, thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Corti.
You are so generous.